With this, may I please take the pleasure of introducing Dr. Ram Kundania to all of you. He is an expert in the field of management, especially in the business of agriculture. He has a total corporate experience of about 35 years at very senior positions. He is an author, strategic management consultant, teacher, and a policy analyst in India. A graduate in agriculture sciences from the Andhra Pradesh Agriculture University, and a postgraduate diploma in management with a specialization in agriculture from the Indian Institute of Management, Ahmedabad. He has worked for 22 years in agrochemical industry and co-founded ThinkAg, which is a platform to promote innovation and entrepreneurship in food and agriculture sectors in 2018. He is a partner with global philanthropic organization called Social Venture Partners in their Hyderabad chapter, which helps NGOs to scale up their operations. He has a wide experience in the area of policy advocacy for agriculture input industry. He writes regularly in the print media about various agricultural matters of national importance with particular reference to the policy interventions. With this, may I please welcome Dr. Ram Kundania, and sir, please preside over the webinar.
Thank you very much, Nidhi. Thanks for that generous introduction. I have a few slides which I will try to present about the biotechnology situation. So I think in general, India is among, I will share the screen. I have the share screening rights. You have given me the rights, Nidhi, to share the screen.
Yes, sir. I have. You made you the co-host. You should. It should be there, just below.
So there may be green icon. Green icon. Share screen.
Yes, sir.
One minute.
Yeah, you can open the application window, and yeah, if you have that on your desktop, then it should be fine.
Yeah. I thought I kept it open, but looks like I closed it. Can you see my screen now?
Yeah.
Yes, sir. Yeah, I can see. Okay. Thank you. Okay. So I have a few slides, but let me just tell you very briefly about our association. We are an association of what is called Federation of Seed Industry of India. This is an association of research-based seed companies. We are about 42 members we have. Dr. Shivendra Bajaj is our executive director. He is also on the call. Dr. Ratna Kumaria is our director of biotechnology. She is also on the call. We have a subgroup within the association, a special interest group called Alliance for Agri Innovation, which focuses on biotechnology. So we undertake policy advocacy work on behalf of all our members in both biotechnology and seed space. So that's our background, just to give you some idea about us. And I am the director general of the association. Just to talk about seed industry, seed technology has evolved over a period of time. You know, all of us know that for centuries, farmers have grown traditional varieties, which are tall and they are lower in yields and highly susceptible to diseases, but they had their own output advantages in terms of taste and nutrition and various things. But in that led to a situation in the early 60s when we didn't have enough food and we had to get donation of food from the US. So then the Green Revolution came. Green Revolution is based on what are called dwarf varieties, high-yielding varieties, HYVs these are called, with very high yield potential. So the tall traditional varieties were replaced with high-yielding varieties in rice and wheat particularly. So in both the cases, the traditional varieties as well as HYV, the farmer can save the seed because these are what are called open-pollinated varieties. In an open pollinated variety, the farmer can save seed from his previous crop and sow it as a new crop again. The 70s, we had the revolution in terms of hybrids. Hybrids came in different crops in the 70s, cotton, jawar, bajra, maize and various crops. So they have actually shown, and I will talk a little more about hybrids and things like that later. So they have shown higher yield and disease tolerance. And in the hybrids case, farmer has to buy seed every year. So because the F2 generation will not resemble F1 generation, so there will be segregation. So they have to buy the seed every year. In the last 20 years, molecular markers have increased the speed and precision of breeding. So in all these things, traditional plant breeding has remained consistent and constant through the application of any of these technologies. Plant breeder is still the main person who has to introgress and integrate all the technologies into the final seed that the farmer buys. So molecular markers have become very important in the last 20 years, which increase the speed and precision of breeding. In the last decade, or I should say last 16 years, since 2002, last 18 years actually, GM has come, and GM cotton is the only crop, GM crop, which is allowed in India. And we are currently growing almost 12 million hectares of GM, 11.5 million hectares of GM BT cotton in India. Whether it is molecular markers or whether it is GM traits, they all can be used in both OP varieties and hybrids. This is something which scientists understand, but many common people don't understand that. So I think there is no restriction on the use of any of these technologies in either OP crops or in hybrid crops. Challenge of food security, I'm sure all of you must have already done this many times. So we have actually, we will be touching 9 billion people. The world will touch 9 billion people by 2050. India will be crossing 150 crores much before that. And we will be the largest populated country in the world. climate change is taking place. So we have seen that between 2016 and 2050, we will have 1.3 degrees increase in temperature. Every 1 degree increase in temperature will lead to 25 to 30% fall in yields. This is the projections that are made. So there is a huge impact on yields, which can happen in the next 30 years. Arable land is coming down per capita basis. Pests are increasing. Annual spread of crop pests towards north and south poles in kilometer terms is 3 between 1960 and 2016. So there are various parameters you can see here, that because of various parameters, we can conclude that the security, food security challenge is increasing. Food security can be measured in three terms, three dimensions. One is availability, which is based on production of food. Second is accessibility, which is based on distribution of food. Third is a very important one, which is affordability. That means based on the price of food. If you see the pyramid structure, the bottom of the pyramid in India, out of 150 crores, so currently we are 135 crores, we still have more than 25-30% of our people who are below poverty line. So the bottom of the pyramid will always need cheaper food. So the challenge for agriculture is to produce cheaper and affordable food for the bottom of the pyramid, and at the same time produce food for the top of the pyramid, which is specialized, which is nutritious, which is which may be more expensive, but it meets the needs of more educated and more advanced people at the top of the pyramid, those who can afford to pay for it. There are different types of technologies, and the need for technologies is growing because of all the challenges we talked about. With increasing demand for food and limited resources, one of the impacts of our green revolution is that there has been a serious drain on the natural resources, which is in terms of water and soil. We have used quite a lot. Our emphasis on rice and wheat has also contributed towards this because of the way, I mean, I don't want to go into all the details, but I think the entire policy framework was structured towards encouraging rice and wheat, including our MSP system, our procurement system, and our food habits and everything. So this has actually contributed to a situation where today we produce a lot of it. We store almost 80 million tons of food grains, which is essentially wheat and rice. We export almost 50,000 crores worth of rice. And rice, you know that every kilo of rice needs 5,000 liters of water for production. So I think there is a skewed distribution of our crops currently in the country. But whatever it may be, but one of the targets currently is not only handling climate change, but also handling preserving natural resources like soil and water. So we need efficient ways. So this is where technology can help us. Hybrid technology helps us in terms of disease tolerance and higher yields. This I already talked about it. And there is GMO technology, which we all know, genetic engineering, which provides very precise way of either battling with pests or water shortages, droughts, or it could be with fertilizer application and various. We'll talk more about that later. GWAS and MES, these two are breeding programs, can be made efficient with GWAS and combined with genome-wide marker data. This is another technology that is available to us. So gene editing is the latest among these technologies. It allows breeders to make specific changes. So that actually, I will also talk a little more about that later. Plant breeding and biotechnology, if you see, biotechnology is a more precise science of transferring genes. Traditional plant breeding, when you transfer a gene from the donor plant to the commercial plant variety, it moves along with some other genes, which are not actually required. So the traditional plant breeding, actually, that's why it involves a lot of cleaning up work to be done afterwards through back crossing. They'll have to remove the genes which are not desirable. Whereas in plant biotechnology, you can add a single gene to the strand in a very precise way, very quick way, so that you don't have to waste time in eliminating the genes which are getting undesired genes which are getting transferred to the commercial plant variety. So this is very simply spoken. This is how plant biotechnology makes it a very precise science. Gene editing like I mentioned, is the latest one. The knowledge regarding sequence associated with a trait is used to make precise changes to the elite commercial variety. So this is how the sequence data associated with the trait is transferred, and it is used with a single change. And this could be from a wild variety or another crop species and things like that. So the commercial variety gets improved by the use of this technology. There are different types of things in this. One is targeted mutation, make small nucleotide deletions or additions to silence an allele. There is a targeted edit, recreate allele from plant's own wild relatives. The third is targeted insertion, insert genes from plant's own gene pool. The fourth one is more complicated, in the sense you insert gene from outside the plant's gene pool. So these are four types of ways in which you can do gene editing. And that's why the new gene editing guidelines, which have been developed by Government of India, address each one of these things. Biotech is a very extremely time consuming research. It takes almost, there are four phases in which, it can take almost, many years, more than 10 years to actually bring out a trait. And it can cost quite a lot of money in terms of more than $100 million minimum. And it can be even upwards of that to bring out one trait. And in each phase, there are different activities from high throughput screening, to model crop testing, then gene optimization, crop transformation, then trait development, pre-regulatory data generation, large-scale transformation, then trait integration, field testing, regulatory data generation, product development, and finally regulatory work, seed bulk up, pre-marketing and product development work. So I think from discovery till actual commercialization, it is a very long process. And this is where actually some of the job opportunities come, because this is also a place where a lot of technical people get employed. So this, just for you to understand this, thousands of genes are tested, but finally only one of them gets selected for commercialization. So this is a normal discovery process where you go through a funnel, and then at the end of it, you come up with one product which can be commercialized. The regulations are very, under the EPA, Environment Protection Act 1986, we have regulations which govern the use of genetically modified organisms in the country. This is the same act and same agencies which control GM are rDNA products. GM crops are rDNA products in pharmaceuticals also. It is all done by the same people. Ministry of Environment and Department of Biotechnology, both are involved. The Department of Biotechnology is under Ministry of Science and Technology. Under Ministry of Environment, there is GEAC, so which is the highest body which actually approves. It used to approve, now it is called finally assessment committee only. So finally, it is the minister who approves. But GEAC is the one which is the highest decision-making body in this. Under Department of Biotechnology, there is RCGM, which actually the it helps in preparation of guidelines, protocols, biosafety protocols, and then generation of data. All that is done under the supervision of the RCGM. Every organization has an IBSC, which is Institutional Biosafety Committee, and the IBSC has a nominee from DBT. So the IBSC actually supervises the work being done at individual organization level. So it is a very elaborate structure. Everything related to genetic modification, whether it is imports or exports for R&D, field trials, production, release, inspection, investigations, or any punitive actions, all of them are done by GEAC. So it is finally the GEAC, and you must have read recently that there is also some guidelines being developed for import of genetically modified foods. You know, this that will come under the FSAAI, which is the Food Safety Authority of India. So that is another organization. So they also, with the help of GEAC, they formulate guidelines for even import of GM food. So I think this is one of the most regulated and controlled technologies in the world. If you look at gene editing, I mentioned that new regulations for gene editing have been released recently by the DBT. And in this, there are three types of, let's say the four types I talked about earlier, are treated separately for the purpose of regulation. Evaluation and approval, as the case may be, by IBSC of the Institute for Research to Develop the Mutants under Contained Environment, with report to RCGM. So there are four categories. One is the product developed by targeted mutagenesis, which I mentioned earlier in the earlier slide. The second is product developed by targeted mutagenesis with allele replacement in indistinguishable form from natural variation. So in first two cases, it is indistinguishable from natural variation. So that is a very important aspect of that. The third one is product is developed by targeted mutagenesis with a novel combination of genes, a chimeric gene or promoter from primary or secondary gene pool, and indistinguishable from wide hybridization. So this is the third category. So these three categories are treated as less dangerous. I mean, I'm using the word dangerous. It is not really dangerous. These are at a lower level of technology. So they are reviewed by IBSC, and then this release of these varieties is through notification as per the legislations under the Seed Act. So this doesn't actually go through detailed regulations like the GM crops go through. But the fourth one, which is the product developed by targeted transgene, foreign gene integration. So if you bring a gene from another organism, which is also the principle used in genetic modification, here also through gene editing, if you bring it, then it goes to the RCGM and GEAC. It needs biosafety clearance, just like GM crops, for environment, food, and feed safety as per the existing guidelines. So these guidelines have been put out recently, and these are very much similar to what you have in the US. Of course, all of you may be knowing that there is a difference between the way genetic gene-edited crops are treated in the US and Europe. Europe treats all of them like GM. They have to pass through the regulations like GM. But the US has taken this type of approach, and our current guidelines are following a pattern like this here, where they have differentiated between bringing a gene from outside for gene editing and bringing a gene from within, and indistinguishable from natural variations, and indistinguishable from wide hybridization. When a character is indistinguishable, there are other challenges which are related to intellectual property protection and things like that. But I think as far as the gene editing regulations are concerned, this is the way they have been put up. And this, we believe, is quite a progressive one. And hopefully, they should get finalized. Like I mentioned earlier, GM crops are the most extensively tested ones for safety. Currently, we have more than 3,000 scientific studies to assess the safety of these crops for human health and environmental impact. We had 24 years of adaptation of biotech across the world. 1996, the first GM crops were approved in the world. And we are now we have got 24 years of experience. Biotech plantation over 5 billion acres. Cumulatively, when we talk in these 24 years, we have planted more than 5 billion acres. And we have eaten trillions of meals with the GM ingredients. Even people who quote that Europe doesn't use GM crops, doesn't grow GM crops, should know that Europe is one of the largest importers of GM foods and food GM ingredients, and they do consume them. 300 technical and scientific institutions globally and in India that recognize the safety of GM crops and their potential benefits. In fact, European Union had constituted a study, and then they concluded that the use of this technology they have done a meta-analysis and then shown that it is a safe technology. In Europe itself, they have done. And of course, in WHO and other American organizations, they have always certified this as safe technology. So I think there is no doubt, there is enough evidence to show that GM is safe. GM crops have really occupied very large areas, and they have been consistently growing up. So it is actually 10 Latin American countries, 9 Asia Pacific countries, 2 North American countries, 2 countries in EU, and 3 African countries are growing GM crops today. US is the largest one with 75 million hectares. India is the fifth one with 11.6 million hectares. We have only one crop, but the US is growing many crops. So I think soybean and corn are the largest grown GM crops in the world. And herbicide tolerance is the largest used trait in the world, followed by BT, which is the insect resistance. Combination of herbicide tolerance and insect resistance is used in most of these acres. The new technologies are also there. So currently, about 191.7 million hectares. This is 2018. It has actually crossed 200 million hectares in 2019. So that is this is the data which is of 2018. And the impact of GM crops on environment and farmer income, which has been captured through various studies, and this is a study done by the PG Economics from London. That plant biotechnology has helped to lift entire communities out of poverty, creating a growth in farm income. So $225 billion of additional farm income was generated in the last 25 years. GM insect resistance technology has added $59.5 billion to the income of global maize farmers, while GM herbicide technology in soybeans has delivered $62 billion extra farm income. For each dollar invested in biotech crop seeds in 2018, farmers worldwide gained an average 3.45. That means cost-benefit ratio of 1:3.45. There is a better quality. Just to explain a little bit, that the amount of carbon emission reduction which has happened is equal to removing 10 million cars, that means 1 crore cars from the roads. So I think it is a very huge impact on the environment, because for the same amount of food, if we had to produce today, we would have put many more acres under cultivation. We had to bring many more acres under cultivation. So the impact and the benefits of GM technology are well documented, and and the safety is also well documented. Top 5 countries, this I have already mentioned. I think this is, but in India, if you see, BT Brinjal was approved in 2002, and 2005 BT2 was approved. 2010, BT Brinjal was put under moratorium. On the right side of the slide, you can see this, that BT Brinjal was approved by GAC, but the minister had put it under moratorium in 2010. GM mustard came for approval in 2017, and it is still with the minister. GAC has approved it, recommended for approval rather, and the minister has not approved it as yet. It is still lying with him. BT cotton came from, it is a Monsanto technology. BT Brinjal was brought by Myco, based on Monsanto's gene. But GM mustard is from Delhi University. It is our own indigenously developed technology. And you might be also aware that currently there is another BT Brinjal which is going for testing. And there is a lot of news about it. That BT Brinjal has come from IARI, which is again developed by our own national institute and licensed out to private industry. So this is the history of GM in India. There are many crops like BT cotton has produced fantastic benefits for the people. It was introduced in 2002. That time we were importer of cotton. We have actually 7.5 million farmers who are cultivating BT cotton today. We are now the largest cotton producer in the world because of the benefits we got out of this. We have touched almost 38 million bales of production in 2017, which used to be 13 million bales before BT came. So that means we have almost tripled our production, and we have doubled our acreage. Used to be 9 million hectares before BT cotton came. Now we have touched almost 12 million hectares. So acreage has gone up by about 3 million hectares, which is about 30-35% increase in acreage. But our production went up three times. So that actually shows that the doubling of yields has happened from almost 270 to 80 kgs per hectare. The yields have gone to around 550 kgs per hectare. So there is a huge impact of this on not only on cotton production, but also on our textile industry. Our textile industry during this period has also grown tremendously because of the availability of cotton. There are other biotech applications other than cotton which are possible in India. We can use it in pulses to control bollworm. I mean, the same bollworm, American bollworm, which actually affects even our pulses. We have oilseed crops where edible oils we import almost 60,000-70,000 crores worth. So we can also use biotech in mustard and soybean to improve our yields. This is also an area which we can do. We can use fertilizer use efficiency. You know that we are all trying to reduce fertilizer use in the country because of the damaged soils that has taken place. If we can use nitrogen use efficiency or phosphorus use efficiency traits, we will be able to reduce the consumption of fertilizers in the country, thereby saving our soils and saving also fertilizer subsidy. It is possible to have drought and salinity tolerance through the biotech trait. So again, these are GM traits. That is also possible that we can have almost 25-30% less water requirement if we use the drought tolerance trait. Salinity tolerance, we have almost 20 million hectares of saline soils in the country. If we use this trait, we should be able to grow crops in that. And overall yield increase traits are also available globally, and we should be able to use them. There are 23 crops being developed in the country. More than 25 public sector and 15 private organizations are involved in this. You can see the range of crops: cotton, maize, rice, pulses, oil seeds, millets, vegetables, sugarcane. These are all under development currently in the country in different stages. But I should say that in the last, particularly last 10 years, the development has taken some, the speed of development has taken a beating because of the regulatory uncertainty. Many people feel that they might invest and develop some new application and new trade, but there is no certainty that the regulatory clearance will come, as we have seen with BT Brinjal and GM mustard. So that has actually put the clock back a little bit. So the investments have been reduced to a large extent. And the scientists were a bit confused whether to invest more in this or not. Commercial organizations are also a bit confused about where to invest. But I should also say that the recent let's say in the recent 1.5 to 2 years, there are more positive signals coming from the government. Hopefully that should get converted into some approvals in the short run. They are also talking of oil seeds, particularly soybean. If we can introduce GM technology to control weeds, there could be a major improvement of yields. You are all aware that farmers of cotton are already agitating for herbicide tolerance in cotton, because weed management has become a big issue in many of these crops, and which is affecting yields. The labor availability and labor cost have gone up so high. So currently, in many of the crops, 40 to 60% of the total cost of cultivation for the farmer is on labor. So the farmers also want technologies which will reduce labor costs. So in that sense, also these technologies will be very useful. So there is a thinking in the government right now to use them in some priority areas like oil seeds. It could then extend to pulses and other crops where there is a need for the country to increase production, reduce imports, and that kind of a thing. So I think I should say that there is a slight positive indication. Hopefully that should lead to a more robust research investments into this. Indian seed industry, just to give you some idea, we are about 18,000 crore size right now. It's highly fragmented with more than 150 companies, including MNCs. Government plays a big role in distribution of seed for the main food crops, food grain crops, through the National Seed Corporation and various state seed corporations. Seed production is the key. You know, seed production is concentrated only in a few states because of the agroclimatic suitability. It generates huge rural employment and revenue for seed growing. I should also mention that seed industry is dominated currently by vegetables. Vegetables is around 35% of this market size is in vegetable seeds. Cotton is around 16 to 17%, along with maize. Maize is also around 16 to 17%. Rice is around 10 to 11%. So these are the major crops in which the seed industry is dealing today. Now let me come to career opportunities. I will have a few slides on career opportunities. And like I mentioned, there are various areas in which careers are possible in the biotech space. Careers are not monochrome or monolithic and hardly limited by academic degrees. So there are various areas in which you can have careers. Regulatory is a big area. I think that is something on which you can see that core R&D, of course, is there. So R&D is one area, regulatory is another, marketing, go-to-market strategies, technical, because as we use more technologically advanced seeds, we need more education of the stakeholders, whether it is a farmer or the trade which delivers the technology to the farmer, or even other stakeholders like government extension agencies. They all need training. So this is another area where there is opportunity for in the go-to-market strategies. Market intelligence in chemistry, data analytics is another big area. You know, in the entire usage of digital technologies, even whether it is for research data analysis, is a big area which is coming up. IPR, you know, intellectual property is always there are enough disputes in intellectual property that people with high knowledge in scientific matters related to this will always be useful, along with the lawyers. You know, the lawyers will need the scientific help in analyzing some of these things. IPR is another area. Business development, I talked about that. How do you actually identify the opportunities for application of these technologies? Where will each technology give the best returns? The cost benefit we talked about earlier. Which technology will have the best cost benefit in which application is something also on which scientific work is required, scientists are required. Field testing is a huge area. I think that is something on which currently we have a lot of apprehensions among civil society people who use this as a reason to block testing of new technologies. So how do you do field testing, open field testing of these technologies in a safe and secure way, so that it doesn't escape into the environment, and there is a complete protocols, and then data collection, data analysis, and also disposal of the material which is generated out of that field testing. All that is a huge area again, which is where, you know, a lot of ICR does a lot of work, but also private industry is doing work. And there are contract research organizations which are actually undertaking some of this work. R&D portfolio management, project management, these are all areas where people with scientific background can get involved. So like we have seen on both sides, we have finance, law, data science, business, agronomy, patent science, people management, marketing. Cross-functional discipline roles are most, they throw up most of the opportunities because, you know, we have many functional experts, but if you can develop cross-functional expertise, that will actually open up more opportunities for you. Technical expertise required for agri-biotechnology. You can see here that there are various areas and some of them are repeated from the previous slide. But I think what is not mentioned in the previous slide, I will say quality management, for example. How do you manage the quality of a GM crop, okay, or a biotech crop? How do you check the quality? How do you make sure that you produce a crop with that level of purity? You know, in an insect or resistant crop, we insist on a minimum 99% purity. But if it is a herbicide resistant crop, herbicide tolerant crop, purity has to be even more, because if the purity is even 1% less than 100, 1% of the plants will die when you apply that herbicide, and 1% plants are very valuable for the farmer. So how do you maintain that purity? How do you maintain that quality? That is another area. Safety and biosafety areas are there. Human resource management is also a big area here. Regulatory affairs, I'll put regulatory affairs as an area which has a huge opportunity. Patent science, intellectual property, scientific affairs, that means dealing with the scientific organizations, working with other scientists who are working in this space and creating collaborative approaches, all that is scientific affairs. And data science, programming, bioinformatics, we have, you know, some of the global corporations and global institutions have built such huge capacity in bioinformatics, particularly in crops like maize. But there are crops which are relevant to India in which we should build some of those capabilities in bioinformatics, computational biology, predictive analytics. So some of the roles are in research, in IT, plant breeding, TD, what is called TD, which is involving field testing and various other technology related stewardship matters, legal, communications. Communication is a big area. Actually, we don't give enough importance to communication. Science communication in India is a huge area of opportunity because we are very poor at science communication in the country. How do we communicate science to ordinary man? How do we communicate about the safety of food to an ordinary housewife? Because she's the one who decides about what food is eaten at home, right? That is in the hands of the housewife normally. So how do we communicate to her that this technology is safe? How do we communicate to her that this technology is what is nothing different than what the farmer has been doing for hundreds of years? So I think these are all, communication is a highly underrated subject. This is where actually more scientists should get in. Stewardship, I already talked about. Compliances, you know, compliances with regulations is also that auditing and that type of setting up processes to ensure full compliance. So there are various roles in which this is all possible. So this is a table which gives you technical expertise required under different verticals. Biotechnology research, with a master or a doctorate in agri-biotechnology, the following paths may be followed in public or in industry, in public sector or in industry. In the research area, you have lab and field research, or just support in lab and field research, quality checks and analysis, program pipeline management, that is all under research. Technical writing, regulatory dossiers, technical communication, product dossiers, business outreach. I would put also outreach, business outreach is also general common public outreach. Also, I'll put there that it is a very important area. Data management and analytics may need some additional degrees on data management here. Big data analytics, image analysis, data connectivity, equipment programming and management. These are all skills that are required under this vertical. Biotech and safety, This is again entire subject lab and field safety management, safety compliances and audits, safety related technical documentation, and the last one is others. We may need additional degrees like market planning, competitive intelligence, and strategic planning, some of these things. So these are a few verticals under which it is possible to find careers and jobs in this particular space. But important is also that how do you build the soft skills which are necessary to actually work? You know, technical competence is one, but I think soft skills is an area where many scientists need some special attention, because how do you build relationships? Some of the core competencies which are required are how do you build relationships, networks, both internally and externally. Result orientation is very important. You know, unfortunately, scientific community in India is more focused on producing academic work rather than commercially relevant work. So result orientation to deliver in a structured and unstructured situations means it should produce results for the farmer. Finally, at the end of the day, how much area is occupied by your scientific work? How much area the farmer is planting as a, using your scientific work? I think that is what matters finally. We should have the initiative and foresight to assess short-term and long-term priorities. Is it a priority for us to invest in rice? Is it a priority for us to invest in, let's say, red gram? Okay, those are the kind of discussions which one should be able to apply your mind to. Agility to adapt to changing business context. You know, businesses are undergoing a huge change. This decade will see a huge change in consumption patterns of people. When consumption patterns change and they move to more nutrition-based and immunity-based foods as a result of some of it is coming out of the COVID situation, but also there is a bigger agenda under sustainable development goals, SDGs, that the world has to move towards more sustainable food systems. So when you move towards sustainable food systems, what crops do you grow? Crops you grow will depend on what foods you actually consume. So how do we modify all that? So there will be a huge change which will happen. And so one has to understand all that. So external understanding the external environment and what's happening in that environment, how it will impact the use of technology is also very important. Courage and candor to say and do the right things. You know, unfortunately, we have a culture in India where we always say yes to the boss, right? So this culture is there in scientific organizations and commercial organizations everywhere, because that's how we are brought up. But do we have the courage and the candor to say no or express our opinions? Does the boss have the courage to allow people to express their opinions? These are all some of the skills that are needed. Organizational fit. How do you balance between individual drive and team play? We are not very great as Indians. We are not very great at team work. We are very good at individual work. We excel in individual work. But at the same time, we try to pull down the other fellow quite easily. So this is also something which comes out of competitiveness because the resources and opportunities are limited. Just out of sheer competition, we try to work only for individual brilliance. So I think this is also something which needs to be developed. How do you work as a team? How do you produce results as a team and not give too much importance to individuals? Common sense based approach to problem solving, humility in thought and action. These are all things which some of them are philosophical, but many of them are what are called soft skills, which are needed for us to find. See, finding job is not as difficult as managing careers. See, these are all for careers. When you manage a career, how do you actually get the best out of your career will depend on many of these soft skills, because you may still get selected in an interview process, but will you be able to excel in your work will depend on many of these competencies. So for this, you have to know yourself, discover what you enjoy doing. You must have the learning agility, listening skills, respect for peers. Integrity is very important. And Your degrees should not constrain you. Degrees should only actually enable you. You have to think beyond your degrees and see what you like to do. And you should be a driver. Whichever work you do, you should excel. And you should be a driver, not a passenger in a company. So these are a few thoughts. I think that should be the last one. Yeah. So this is basically, just to add to this, both public sector and private sector organizations offer you job opportunities. I think many of them, all the public sector like ICAR and all others, they do conduct all India exams. Maybe can I request either Ratna, you are there?
Yeah. So as Mr. Konya has already told us that once you have your degrees, the opportunities are tremendous. He's already explained the huge pipeline that we have in agri-biotechnology, be it in government institutes or private industry. And I think you just have to figure out where in that huge pipeline you fit in yourself, or you see yourself excelling. For institutes, we have an All India exam that you have to pass, or you could become part of projects. Though these are temporary positions as long as the project lasts, but these temporary positions are there in all government institutes. Private industry tends to hire people both who are freshers as well as people who have some experience, and your remuneration will accordingly be balanced out with that. But again, the pipeline is huge. You can start with a core research. You could be part of a research team, or you could be a support for a research team. Support would include just the analytics of the work done by the research team. So you could be that, or you could be in the product development, quality check, regulatory aspect, or you could be as a technical writer or maintenance for any part of this whole pipeline. Again, as I said, that you could join in as a permanent employee or in a project, which is generally for 2 to 3 years as per the progress of the project. Generally, what we have seen, careers begin with people joining in a project just to wet their feet and to realize as to what is the best fit for them. So many people go through projects so that they can decide which is the field they want, and then they take up the exam and clear out to join an institute. There are multiple ICAR institutes across the country. There are specific for crops. They are specific for the projects. You could have a institute quite close to where you live, or you could go to the major ones. Besides the ICAR institutes, you have the agriculture universities. All of them have multiple projects ongoing. You could become part of any of the agriculture universities. If you are a core biotechnology or molecular biology kind of a person, then there are big institutes. You could join the research institutes located more in Hyderabad and Bangalore, but you do have some in the northern part of India also. Most of them are again associated or affiliated with one of the major universities. So university towns tend to have more of these institutes around them.
Can you give some names, Ratna, can you give some names of those
institutes? Like Hyderabad, if you're in Hyderabad, you go to CCMB, right? If you're in Bangalore, it's ISC Bangalore. So these have IITs. IITs, all IITs now have a biotech program. So wherever you are, if there's an IIT around you, there are biotech programs. I was just about to mention, DBT has just 2 years or 1.5 years back made a new institute in Delhi. NGGF. Now this is National Institute for Genomics and Genotyping. What they do is do a lot of sequencing and then just do the phenotype of that, like associate the sequence with the agronomy of the plant. So that's a huge, huge opportunity. It's a very core molecular biology work. Many of the product companies, Illumina, Eurofin, all these are companies which do sequencing for projects. They also hire a lot of people, core molecular biology people who are good with handling equipment, programming them, doing timeline based jobs. So there are a lot of private opportunity if you are a molecular biology person, and these are contract research institutes, organizations. Lots of opportunities there, but they are very pure technical jobs. Again, a matter of your choice. India, like Illumina, has a major presence in India. Eurofin is again a major presence. Keygenes is a presence. So these are companies which either do hands-on equipment work, so that they are giving you the data. They analyze data for you. Lots of companies do that also. And so it depends on your skill, but the opportunities are definitely there. Seed company, most of them have a huge R&D setup with them, and you could be part of their setup too. Again, they'll have basic discovery research, product development, quality checks, regulatory aspects of it, and then they have research station. Most of the seed industry would have research stations throughout the major markets that they cater to. And you could be part of the research station wherever the trials are done, wherever their testing is done. Again, more of a technical job. Or you could, is open to you within the private industry. So private industry, same as in the research institute, could be a core or a support. So either you could be in a core seed industry or you could be in a CRO. So again, as I said, most of it is your choice. There are lots of opportunities around there. Yeah, so your experience will actually decide on the remunerations. And as you grow in this field, I think the returns are pretty satisfying. That's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ratna. Thank you, Dr. Ram, for a wonderful presentation that you put together for the audience today.